progress. X is now the independent variable, and Y the dependent variable. For evident reasons, I think, normally choose X first. Value of X determines the dependent variable Y through the function f. The graph of the function f means all points whose Cartesian coordinates are of the form X f of X. And it is a very useful tool to provide a graphic image, literally, a graphic image of the function. Let's take an example, the function f of before. I give myself coordinate axes. I'm going to indicate what the scale is of these axes for x and for y. You notice the scale is different, but that's all right. This is very commonly the case. Let us call the graph of the function capital G. Here's a way to generate points that are on the graph. I choose a value of x, and I evaluate f, and that'll give me the y. For example, f of 0 is equal to 1. That means, by definition, that the point 0, 1 is on the graph of the function. Let's put it into the picture. There it is. Similarly, f of 1 is equal to 3. That tells me the point 1, 3 is on the graph. I add that to the plot that I'm making. F of 2 is 5, gives me this point. And f of 3 is 7, gives me yet another. I can also take negative values of x. F of minus 1 is minus 1, which means the point minus 1, minus 1 is on the graph. Let's add it to the picture. When we have enough points, we can comfortably draw the graph, and you know it looks a lot like a straight line. In fact, it is a straight line. It's a straight line because f is an affine function. What does affine mean? A function f is affine if its defining formula is of the form mx plus b for two parameters m and b. It's a general fact that the graph of an affine function is a line. The parameter m is called the slope of the line, and in fact it measures how steep the line might be, whether it's going up or down. If m is positive, for example, the line goes up as we move to the right. If m is negative, it goes down, and if m is zero, then you have a flat line, a constant function. The parameter b is called the y-intercept of the line, for the following simple reason. If you look at the point where the line intersects the y-axis, it describes the value y equals b. We'll have more on graphs in the next segment. Discuss monotonicity properties of functions. The word monotonicity refers to increase or decrease. A function is called increasing if it satisfies this condition. Roughly speaking, if the argument is bigger, then the value of the function is bigger. It's called strictly increasing if the inequality is strict. We can turn for an example to our affine functions that we discussed before. A function of the form mx plus b is increasing if and only if its slope m is a positive number. If m is positive, you have an increasing function. If m is negative, you have what is called a decreasing function. And if m is zero, you have a constant function. Let's examine now the graph of the function g that we saw before, g of x equals x squared. We give ourselves some coordinate axes, we plot a few points, and we trace the curve of the graph, and we come to something very famous, a curve whose name is in the dictionary. It's called a parabola. And satellite dishes, incidentally, are in parabolic shape for a more focused reason that I won't get into. Now this function g is an even function. That means it assigns the same value to minus x as it does to x. What that means for the graph is that the graph displays a certain symmetry. The graph is symmetric, we say, with respect to the y-axis. The meaning of this? If you look at the right-hand branch of the graph, when you rotate it around the y-axis, we come upon the left-hand branch. This is symmetry with respect to the given axis. So here's our function, and there's its graph. I ask you, is g an increasing function? Well, clearly not. G decreases when you're on the left of x, and it increases when you're on the right. However, let us observe that if we were to restrict attention to the positive x's, then it would be an increasing function. So we could restrict attention to r plus, as it's called. Standard notation, r plus means the positive numbers in r, the interval 0 to infinity. More generally, we have the following proposition. For any positive integer n, the function phi, defined to be the nth power of the argument, is a strictly increasing function on r plus. Here, of course, x to the n, or x power n, nth power of x, means x multiplied n times. That proposition we're now going to prove, because we haven't had the fun of doing the proof in a little while. Here's the proof. It's my induction. We're going to first prove it for n equals 1. We're going to prove that the function x matched to x is strictly increasing on r plus. That amounts to checking that x less than y implies x less than y. Well, that's pretty evidently the case, so the case n equals 1 has been disposed of. Next, and finally, we have to prove that whenever x to the power n is strictly increasing on r plus, the same is true of the next power, n plus 1. We'll take two numbers, x less than y, positive. We must show this inequality. That inequality is certainly true if x is 0, so let's assume x is strictly positive. Now we apply the induction hypothesis, the truth for n. So we have x n less than y n. If we take that strict inequality and multiply it by the strictly positive number x, we'll obtain this, which I'm going to save for later use. Similarly, if you take the same inequality but now multiply it by y to the n, you get this inequality. Now let's combine the two inequalities we've obtained in a string of relationships. And you can see that we have the first, and we have the second. And if you now look at just the extremities of these relations, you see that we have proved that x power n plus 1 is less than y power n plus 1, which is exactly what was required to prove. So that's the end of the proof. They used to say QED at this point. Now we put this symbol, so perhaps we should say box, or end of proof. We continue our study of graphs. graphs. Let's look at the function x cubed. That is x to the power 3. I call it h here. We can trace its graph as we've done for other functions, and you'll get something like the following curve. Does that curve look odd to you? Well, the function h is odd. H of minus x is the same as minus h of x, as you can check. This property of the function gives you a kind of symmetry, different from the symmetry about an axis that we saw earlier. This gives you symmetry with respect to the origin. The meaning of that is the following. If you take a point x, y on the graph, if you proceed to draw a straight line from x, y through the origin, then you'll meet the point minus x minus y, and that point will also be on the graph. Now, we know from an earlier proposition that the function h is strictly increasing on r plus. But given this symmetry, we can go on to deduce that h is actually strictly increasing globally on the real line. Another function of interest is the function 1 over x. It's clear here that we have to restrict the domain, but we have to avoid the value x equals 0. When we draw the graph of the function, we get something like this. And this curve, the red curve, has the property that as x moves out far to the right, the red curve gets closer and closer to the x-axis without actually meeting it. We say that the x-axis is a horizontal asymptote of the curve. You notice that the function capital F here is an odd function. Therefore, in order to have the left-hand latch of the graph, we can apply symmetry with respect to the origin, and we know it's going to look like this. Look at the behavior of this function at x equals 0, where it's not defined. As x approaches 0 from the right, getting very, very small, you can see the value of the function gets bigger and bigger and goes up to plus infinity, asymptotically. Similarly, as x approaches 0 but from the left, the value goes down to minus infinity, asymptotically. We say that the y-axis is a vertical asymptote in this case. Sometimes functions are defined in a piecewise manner. They have two different defining formulas, depending where the arguments are. For example, you could have a function f that agrees with g if x is less than k, but then switches over to a different function h when x is greater than k. Well, we already have an example of such a function. The absolute value function is of this type. It's given by minus x when x is negative, and by plus x if x is positive. How do we find the graph of absolute x? Well, you can look at the graphs of the two components. The functions minus x and x, those are affine functions, so we know how to graph them. And then we take the left-hand latch of g and the right-hand latch of h, put it together, and have the graph of the function absolute x. Let's speak now about dilation. Dilation means multiplication by a constant. What happens to the graph of a function when you multiply a function by a constant c? Let's take our familiar example, the x squared function, with the parabola being the graph. What happens if we multiply the function by a constant bigger than 1? Well, the answer is the graph will sort of be expanded. It will be dilated upwards because c is bigger than 1. If we multiply by a positive c that was smaller than 1, then the graph will be dilated down. It will get squished. What about negative constants? What if the graph of this function were multiplied by minus 1? In that case, the graph of the new function would be rotated relative to the x-axis. Whatever was positive becomes negative. That will be the graph of the function minus x squared. Another way to measure a function is by translation. For example, one can just add a constant k, a fixed real number, to the values of f. In that case, the graph of f will be vertically translated. That means vertically shifted, up or down depending on the sign of k. Here's an example. What is the graph of the function x squared plus 1? Well, we know the graph of the function x squared is our parabola. And if you want to know the graph of the new function, you just take the old one and shift it up one unit, and that'll be the graph of the new function x squared plus 1. Another way to apply translation is inside the function. We're going to apply f, not at x, but at x plus k, where k is a fixed real number. In that case, it turns out the graph of f will be horizontally translated, left or right. Let's look at this example. What is the graph of x plus 1 squared? Well, if the x plus 1 were the real variable, let's make a change of variables and call x plus 1 capital X. In that case, we would know exactly what the graph looks like in terms of capital X. That would be it. How do we relate that to what the graph should be in terms of our real variable, a lowercase x? Well, the key is to note that capital X equals 0 in the change of variables corresponds to little x equals minus 1. That's where the origin should be shifted to. So we take our graph, we shift it to minus 1, and that is the graph of the new function x plus 1 squared.
X cubed, g prime x to minus 2 times x cubed, and the h prime x to minus 1 over 2 x cubed are strictly decreasing and odd. We have seen in the previous video that the function f is strictly increasing. It is that if x is less than y, we add that x cubed is less than y cubed. Okay, now let us consider two cases. If A is any real number greater than zero, and X is less than Y, then we know that X cubed is less than Y cubed, and multiplying on both sides by the positive real number A, we get that AX cubed is less than AY cubed. Therefore, considering A equal to 2 or to 1 over 2, we get that both G and H are straightly increasing. On the other hand, if A is a real number less than 0, then what we get if we repeat the similar reasoning, we get X less than Y implies X cubed less than Y cubed, but now multiplying by a negative number on both sides, the sequence which it produces, and we get AX cubed greater than AY cubed. Therefore, considering A equal to minus 1 or minus 2 or minus 1 over 2, we get that the functions F prime, G prime, and H prime are strictly decreasing. Okay, and now let us examine if this function are odd or not. What means to be an odd function? Okay, we have for f, g, and h, we have to check which is the image of minus x. Precisely, f minus x is equal to minus x to the cube, which is equal to minus x to the cube, which is equal to minus f of x. Therefore, the function f is odd. Similarly, g of minus x is equal to 2 times minus x to the cube, which is equal to minus 2x to the cube, which is equal to minus g of x. And then also g is odd. Now h of minus x is equal to 1 over 2 minus x to the cube, which is equal to minus 1 over 2x cube, which is minus h of x. And also h is an odd function. What about now f prime, g prime, and h prime? Let us compare again f prime of minus x with minus f prime of x, the same numbers. Then we have f prime of minus x is equal to minus x to the cube, which is equal to x to the cube. And what is minus f prime of x? It is equal to minus f prime of x is minus x cube, and which is equal to the x cube. Therefore, these two are equal, and then f prime is an odd function. Now, g prime of minus x is equal to minus 2 minus x to the cube, which is equal to 2 times x cube. And minus g prime of x is equal to minus 2 x cube, which is equal to 2 x cube. Again, g prime of minus x is equal to minus g prime of x, and then g prime is a function. H prime of minus x is equal to minus 1 over 2 minus x to the cube, which is equal to 1 over 2 x to the cube. And minus h prime of x is equal to minus 1 over 2 x cubed, which is equal to 1 over 2 x cubed. Again, h prime of minus x and minus h prime of x coincide. And therefore, also h prime is an odd function.
Zero is just not defined. There's no way to define it so that things work out.
What are the graphs of these power functions going to look like? We already know two of them. X squared, the parabola, x cubed, that we saw not long ago. We see that for n even, we have a function that is increasing on our plus, whereas for n odd, x cubed, we have a function which is globally increasing. Also, the x squared was an even function, the x cubed was an odd function. Well, these things carry over to other powers. For example, x to the fourth is an even function, which is increasing but only on r plus. It looks a lot like the parabola, but you notice it's much flatter, zero. It's not a parabola. X to the fifth has roughly the same nature as x cubed, and so on. If you zoom in a bit on the first quadrant, you see that the two functions xm and xn agree at x equal 1. All these functions do. They have the value 1 there. The x to the power m, the smaller of the two powers, well, it's higher than the other when you're between 0 and 1, but then it's lower when x is greater than 1. How about negative integer powers? We can define those. Here's how it's done. We take an a different from 0 to avoid division by 0, then we define, as usual, a to the 0 equals 1, and we define a to the power n, where n is a negative integer, by definition, is equal to 1 over a to the power minus n. That's already defined because then minus n is a positive integer. Now, why do we define a to the 0 equal 1? Well, here's one explanation. We would like this law of exponents to still work for 0. And from what I've written down, you can see that this forces a to the power 0 to be the identity element for multiplication, that is 1. Otherwise, this law would fail to hold. Similarly, we have to define a negative exponent base this way, because if we want this law to hold, then a to the minus n has no choice but to be the reciprocal of the other value. For example, what is pi to the power minus 2? It turns out to be 1 over pi squared. What is pi to the power, minus pi rather, to the power minus 3? Answer, it turns out to be minus 1 over pi cubed. Let us note that the following expressions are never defined, 0 to the 0 or 0 to a negative integer power. These facts all hold for integers, which now can be negative as well as positive. And I have some good news. Visually, these facts are exactly the same as they were for positive integer powers. Therefore, we already know these facts, sort of. Anyway, visually, they're the same. Let us now turn to the graphs of powers with a negative integer. We already have one example. Remember the function 1 over x? We saw that it's an odd function. We saw that it was decreasing on r plus, for example. Well, these sorts of characteristics carry over for other negative power functions as well. If n is odd, the graph will look rather similar. It'll define an odd function. And if n is even, it will define an even function, which will be decreasing in the first quadrant. We'll continue our discussion in a moment with roots and radicals.
Exactly 1 over minus pi to the 4. And e to the minus 3 means 1 over e to the 3. On the other side, minus e to the minus 4 means 1 over minus e to the 4th. And pi to the minus 3 means 1 over pi to the 3. And now what we can say about this first number? Here you see you have the fourth power of a negative number. And then what you get? 1 over pi to the 4. And the denominator is 1 over e to the 3. And on the other side, analogously, we have 1 over e to the 4th and 1 over pi to the 3. We'll just continue in this side. And now, of course, we can write this fraction in a more clever way as a to the 3 over pi to the 4, and this other as pi to the 3 over e to the 4th. Okay, we have to compare these numbers. We have to understand if the number on the left is less or equal or greater than the number on the right. Okay, multiplying on both sides by pi to the 4th and by e to the 4th, we get, equivalently, the following problem. Is e to the 7th less, equal, or greater than pi to the 7th?